Welcome to our faith community of Sacred Heart on the fifth Sunday of Ordinary Time. My name is Josh Boss. There is a basket in the back of the church reflecting blessed poems for 4 years to prepare for Ash Wednesday. We are looking forward to the Lenten season and the continuation of the Grateful Living small group sessions. If you are interested in joining or leading a group, please contact Jane Rutter. Call the parish office for contact information. Financial statements for your parish contributions will be available starting January 31st. They will not be mailed out this year, but you may pick yours up at the parish office. On Friday, February 2nd, the church celebrated the World Day of Consecrated Life. This designation honors and prays for those men and women in religious vocations who have consecrated their life to God by the vows of celibacy, poverty, and obedience. The church highlights this celebration this weekend to bring special recognition to these priests, deacons, and nuns, and to thank them. The scripture readings for today are found in the hymnal under 1105. Please check that your cell phones are silent at this time. We've been asked at this Mass to pray for the eternal rest of Joe Pinky. And today we welcome Eleanora Helen Shepherds, daughter of Nicholas Shepherds and Amelia Burr, as she joins the church through baptism. At this time, we ask that you stand and remain standing as you greet or introduce yourself to the branch. Please join us in the opening hymn, number 724, I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say.
Carrying some burdens in life, as we hear about Job in today's first reading.
But we also are assured of a warm welcome from God our Father, despite our faults and failures.
Lord Jesus, you are the healing hand of God. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You are the ways of holiness and holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are the divine presence whom we seek. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on all of us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, if I preach the gospel, this is no reason for me to boast, for an obligation has been imposed on me, and woe to me if I do not preach it. If I do so willingly, I have a recompense. But if unwillingly, then I have been entrusted with a stewardship. What then is my recompense? That when I preach, I offer the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my right in the gospel. Although I am free in regard to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so as to win over as many as possible. To the weak, I became weak, to win over the weak. I have become all things to all, to save at least some. All this I do for the sake of the gospel, so that I too may have a share in it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. To some extent, we can relate to the story of Job and also particularly the gospel that tells about how many people came to Jesus for healing. And some of those physical problems, the medical nature, health issue, and then some of them were really serious, very serious, and being possessed by demons. And so many people came to Jesus for relief, for comfort, and for hope. So the same can be said for us. And actually, even in today's second reading, Paul talks about preaching the gospel. And I've mentioned on a number of occasions in, you know, my homilies to you, that all of us are called to be preachers of the good news. Not necessarily standing up here in front of a congregation like myself or priests or deacons, but all of us are called to be evangelists. And so on this afternoon during this baptism, unbeknownst to Eleonora, she's going to be baptized a preacher. All right? Not just a Catholic, but a preacher. Priest, prophet, and king should be anointed. Priest, prophet, and king. And so all of us have been made prophets through our baptism. And a prophet preaches the word of God and brings the message of good news in the name of Jesus Christ to others. And so, as I've mentioned to you, lots of times that has nothing to do with actually using words. So remember the story, the anecdote told about St. Francis of Assisi and sending out his brothers. He said to them, go out and preach the good news, and if necessary, use words. So we preach the good news by our example, by our modeling, by our witness. And so Nick and Amelia will do that with Eleonora for the rest of her life, all the way up into, and hopefully we pray that for a long life, for the rest of her life. And she's getting all of this out right now so it doesn't happen during the baptism. You always have to, there's humor in everything, right? So, let's look at today's reading, all right? This world will disappoint us. Job, this world can disappoint us. And we make the mistake of thinking that our lives are supposed to be happiness all the time. That's our feelings. Okay? Shouldn't be our thoughts, we should know better. But that's our feelings, that this world should give us happiness or comfort, success, achievement, money, whatever we want all the time. And we know it doesn't do that. So this world can disappoint us. And we also have learned, hopefully, that our feelings are like the weather. They change. All right? Sometimes very dramatically, but certainly regularly, they change. And it's a good thing, because there are times when we really do feel despair, or really feel sadness, and we're overwhelmed by that. And if we just hang in there, like the weather in Missouri, it'll change, all right? And there will sometimes, hopefully, be replaced by happiness, or relief, or hope. And so the same can also be said about lots of circumstances in life. And that's one of the things that we learn as part of maturity, part of growing, certainly in the faith, but also just into adulthood. The circumstances of life can change for the better or for the worse, and we have to be very, very careful about putting too much faith in them. And so where do we put it? We, of course, put it in our faith in God. So that's one of the things that jumps out at us in the story of Job. And actually, the Job story has a good ending, and that's why sometimes people only characterize him as one who was the victim of so many bad circumstances in life. And he was, there's no question about it. But if you read the whole story, you know that he knew that his feelings could change about God or about life in general, and it did for him for the better. He did eventually experience true happiness, and it came about because he didn't give up on God. And so, that's the second lesson we want to remember, that just as feelings can change like the weather, the circumstances of life, our faith even. Sometimes we can have very strong faith in God, and other times it's very weak. And sometimes we're even angry with God, so our feelings towards God can change. Even love. And you, all of you, all of us, know that sometimes the love we have for other people can waver, or can weaken, can change from being very strong and very deep to being very shallow or weak. And so we want to always stick to it and stay committed to it, because that love can change for the better. And the same goes for happiness. And so Job reminded us to hold on to God, even though his friends told him, and even some of his family told him, give up on God. God has cursed you. He's abandoned you. And Job wouldn't do that, because he realized that life is better with God than without God. And that's some of the things that sometimes we have to be mindful of all the time. And that's why, unfortunately, people make the mistake of giving up on God, therefore not going to church, or not going to mass, or not praying, because they figure, why bother? But actually, staying committed to our relationship with God can strengthen us and ultimately bring about a certain peace and happiness, not in the context of this world, but in the context of eternal life. And then, of course, we as Catholics come here to encounter the Jesus that we hear about in today's gospel. And we bring our problems to Jesus that are held private in our hearts, known to him, of course, and not shared with others. But we bring our burdens to Jesus, as those people did so many years ago. And the other thing is, we learn in this story that the people brought others who were in need. And that's why we offer intercessory prayers, petitions, to our Heavenly Father, to Jesus. We pray for the needs of other people. We bring their needs to Jesus in prayer. And so we're sort of carrying on the very same thing that took place in this event or this story in Capernaum 2,000 years ago. But more than anything, just as they encountered Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago, we do too. Not that physical, historical Jesus, but the risen Jesus, who continues to say to us, this is my body, this is my blood. And it's by receiving Jesus at Holy Communion that some of that despair, or some of that sadness, or some of that hurt and pain can lessen a little bit, maybe a lot for some. And so, even though the stories in today's scripture remind us that this world will disappoint us, they also remind us that for good reason we're here, because we know that with God, we have a lot better chance at having a happy life, even in this time and this age, than without. And that's the lesson, that's the journey that Eleanor Helen is going to start in just moments. And so I invite Nick and Amelia, where did Amelia go? There she is. I invite Nick and Amelia to come forward with Eleonora for the waters of baptism. And the godparents.
Very good. So Amelia, I mean Eleanor.
Christian community welcomes you with great joy. In his name I claim you for the Christ our Savior by the sign of his cross. And mom and dad, you make the sign of the cross on your forehead. And Godfather and Godmother. Good job. So I invite you all to please stand. We're going to offer up these special petitions to our Heavenly Father that I mentioned in my homily.
The response to our intercessions is, loving God, hear our prayer. For the church, that it will offer the good news freely, not clouded by human ambition or desire for power, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For those consecrated to God by the vows of chastity, poverty, and obedience, that they may seek to live their baptismal promises more intensely, and have the grace to persevere in the commitment to the Lord, and serve with open hearts and willing spirits, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For the preservation of life in all its stages, praying especially for any baby that is in danger of abortion, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For those who are sick, and for those who care for the sick, especially for those in hospitals and nursing homes, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For the dying, especially those who face death alone with no one at their side, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For Eleanor Helen, marked by the sign of the cross, that she have a long life filled with the Holy Spirit, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For these prayers and for all the intentions that we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
And we pray that through baptism and confirmation, Lord, you'll make Eleonora your faithful follower and a witness to your gospel, we pray the Lord.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
We pray that you make the lives of your parents and godparents examples of faith to inspire her always, we pray to the Lord.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
Renew the grace of our baptism in each one of us, we pray to the Lord.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, be attentive to all our needs, spoken and unspoken, as we present them to you through the intercession of your Son Jesus, who comes to us from the altar this evening in Holy Communion, but also as well lives now and is in glory with you forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. So I ask you to listen carefully to this prayer that I will use to bless the water for Eleonora's baptism. It recalls the stories in Scripture where water played a very significant and important role in God's plan of salvation. Father, you give us grace through sacramental signs which tell us of the wonders of your unseen power. In baptism, we use your gift of water, which you have made a rich symbol of the grace that you give us in this sacrament. At the very dawn of creation, your Spirit breathed over the waters, making them the wellspring of all holiness. The waters of the great flood made a sign of the waters of baptism that make an end of sin and a new beginning of goodness. Through the waters of the Red Sea, you led ancient Israel out of slavery in Egypt to be an image of God's holy people set free from sin by baptism. In the waters of the Jordan River, your Son was baptized by John the Baptist and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Jesus willed that water and blood should flow from his side as he hung upon the cross. After his resurrection, he told his disciples, "Go out and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." Father, look now with love upon your church, and unseal for her the fountain of baptism. By the power of the Spirit, give to the water of his heart the grace of your Son. You created man in your own likeness, cleansing from sin and new birth, to innocent by water and the Spirit. We ask you, Father, with your Son, to send the Holy Spirit upon the water of this font. May all who are buried with Christ in the death of baptism rise also with him to newness of life. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Nick and Amelia, godparents, you have come here to present Eleonora for baptism. By water and the Holy Spirit, she is to receive the gift of new life from God, who is love. On your part, you must make it your constant care to bring Eleonora up in the practice of the faith. See that the divine life which God gives her is kept safe, for the poison of sin should grow always stronger in her heart. If your faith makes you ready to accept this responsibility. Renew now the vows of your own baptism. Reject sin, profess your faith in Christ Jesus. This is the faith of the church. This is the faith in which Eleanor is about to be baptized. So Nick and Amelia, you're going to speak not only for yourself, but for her as well. And then also godparents the same. And all of us will join you in renewing our baptismal promises by responding, I do, to the following six questions. Do you reject Satan?
I do.
With all his works?
I do.
With all his empty promises?
I do.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth?
I do.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, was crucified, died, and was buried, rose from the dead, and is now seated at the right hand of the Father?
I do.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting?
I do.
This is our faith. This is the faith of the church. We are proud to profess it in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Amen.
And so, Nick and Amelia, it is your will that Eleanor and Helen should be baptized in the faith of the church, which we have all professed with you. Eleanor, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's give her a big hand. In ancient times, the scriptures tell us God would choose men or women to serve as king or queen or prophet and would have them anointed with perfumed oil to set them apart. And we do the very same thing thousands of years later now with this oil blessed by our bishop, which, as I mentioned in my homily, designates Eleonora to be a future priest, prophet, and king on behalf of Jesus. God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ has freed you, Eleonora, from sin, given you a new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and has welcomed you into his holy people. He now anoints you with the chrism of salvation, as Christ is anointed priest, prophet, and king. So may you, Eleonora, live always as a member of his body, sharing everlasting life. Amen. Good job. And now I ask the godmother to come forward and place the cloth on Eleonora. Paul tells us that when we are baptized, we are clothed with Christ Jesus. And so, Eleonora, you have become a new creation in this clothing ceremony. See in this white garment the outward sign of your Christian dignity. With your family and friends to help you by word and example, bring that dignity unstained into the everlasting light of heaven. And the God, Father, will light the candle from the Christ candle. Jesus is the light of the world. And so we join that light, and we become that light to others as well. And you can pass that to the parents. Parents and godparents, this light is instructed to be kept burning brightly. Eleanor Helen has been enlightened by Christ. She is to walk always as a child of the light. May she keep the flame of faith alive in her heart. And when the Lord comes, may she go out to meet him with all the saints in the heavenly kingdom. And I present you the new member of Sacred Heart Parish. Now we'll continue with the preparation of the altar and the presentation of gifts. Thank you.
Thank you.
Please pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all this holy church.
O Lord our God, who once established these created things to sustain us in our frailty, grant, we pray, that they may become now for us the sacrament of eternal life through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father most holy. Through your beloved Son Jesus Christ, your Word, through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary. Fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people, Jesus stretched out his hands as he endured his passion on the cross, so as to break the bonds of death and to manifest the resurrection. And so, with the angels and all the saints, we declare your glory now, and with one voice we acclaim.
May praise and glorify you
through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
728, I have not seen.
As I mentioned at the beginning of Mass, we'll close with the blessing of growth. If you have participated in this in the past, you come forward in usual Holy Communion manner, procession manner, but then you can spread out among the six ministers of blessing, receive an individual blessing if you choose to do so. Today we celebrate the Feast of St. Blaise, who was Bishop of Sebaste in Armenia in the 4th century. Before being martyred, he is said to have healed a boy who was choking. Since the 8th century, St. Blaise has been venerated as a patron of those who suffer from diseases of the throat. We pray in a special way today for protection from afflictions of the throat and from other illnesses. The blessing of St. Blaise is a sign of our faith in God's protection and love for us and for the sick. It's an open invitation for everyone, Catholic and non-Catholic, and for all ages, from the very young to advanced years. Please bow your heads. To the intercession of St. Blaise, Bishop and Martyr, may God deliver you from every disease of the throat and from every other illness, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Please go in peace.
Thanks be to God.